Good evening and welcome to this edition of Inside Story, the API's magazine program and where we look at the impact of government's plans, policies and programs on the lives of Vincentians. I am Ashisia Sam. On this evening's program, we meet the Intermediate High School Band. The Logos Hope Floating Book Fair is currently in St. Vincent and the Grenadines. And Dr. Camille Nichols speaks to us on diabetes care. Stay with us. Inside Story continues in just a moment.
Our natural history includes the long-tailed white tropic birds that migrate to our skies and rock faces, the North Atlantic humpback whale that comes to our warm waters to give birth to and nurse their young, the critically endangered hawksbill turtle, and the St. Vincent parrot. These are all creatures that the National Trust seeks to protect for future generations. For more than 40 years, the National Trust has worked to save St. Vincent and the Grenadines' most beloved places, landscapes, and seascapes where great moments of history took place. We work together with communities to value and protect important pieces of our cultural community, national history, and environment, such as the series of decorated Salvadoran pots found in Clear Valley, signifying that St. Vincent's civilization is almost 2,000 years old. We do this all because the next generation needs to know our stories, as they will only inherit the places and species we choose to save today. We urge you to plant a tree under whose shade you never plan to sit. Join the National Trust today.
Thanks for staying with us. The MV Logos Hope is renowned for being the world's largest floating book fair. The Logos is operated by GBA Ships, a non-profit organization based in Germany. The floating book fair has made close to 1,500 port visits in over 150 countries and welcomed over 46 million visitors on board. On November 21st, the Logos Hope docked at Kingston Container Port for a two-week visit to St. Vincent and the Grenadines. An official opening ceremony was held on board the vessel. The API's Shana Daniel was there and tells us more in the following reports.
Along with her wide range of literature, the Logos Hope carries a crew of international volunteers who are dedicated to bringing knowledge, help, and hope to the people of the world. At the official ceremony held aboard the vessel yesterday, November 21st, those in attendance were introduced to some of the over 400 volunteers who come from some 60 different nations of the world.
Godmorgen. My name is Andre. I come from Norway. Welcome on board for Logos Hope.
Good morning. My name is Sarah. I'm from Trinidad and Tobago. Welcome to the Logos Hope.
Доброе утро. My name is Daria. I'm from Russia. Добро пожаловать на борт корабля Logos Hope.
My name is Sotiavi. I'm from Cambodia. Som swakom makan Logos Hope.
Bunadi minyatsa. My name is Anastasia. I am from Moldova. Vinyat svinit pivopor Logos Hope.
Bon dia. My name is Gino Borst and I am from Curacao. Bon bini na Logos Hope.
안녕하세요. My name is Young. I am from South Korea. 로고스 홉에 오신 것을 환영합니다.
구드모닝. My name is Philip.
And my name is Nadine.
And we come from Germany. Willkommen an Bord der Logos Hope.
요 reggelt. My name is Tünde. I am from Hungary. Isten hozta önöket a Logos Hope-on.
家早安。My name is Mercy. I'm from Taiwan. 欢迎来到望道号。
Wow. Isn't this a colorful, beautiful array of people? Just, I'll get out of the way. I'm feeling decidedly underdressed next to them all. Shall we just introduce a few of our crew members? Daria, particularly, your costume is striking. Explain what it is, its significance for everyone, please.
It was almost used for like ancient Russian times, the old times. Now it's only for the parade.
So a decorative costume. It might be a little hard to do your job on board dressed in this. Can you tell everyone what your job on board is, please?
Yes, I work in the book fair department, and I would like to welcome all of you on board.
Wonderful, wonderful. Now, I can't let this man go by unnoticed. Gino, you got a little bit of applause. Explain to people, is this your national costume in Curaçao?
Well, no. In Curaçao, we are super mixed. We have different national costumes, and everybody is mixed. For example, I am mixed. My mom is from St. Vincent. So technically, I'm kind of home. So, yes.
Perfect. Almost like we planned it, but we didn't. Over here, let me also say to Sarah, look at you in your beautiful costume. Explain its significance and your cultural heritage for us.
So I'm from East Indian heritage. So I'm West Indian, not East Indian. My father's side is Indian. My mother's side is Indian and Spanish. So I'm very, very mixed, just like in Curaçao, we're all mixed up. And on special occasions and weddings and even sometimes at church, we wear saris. Yes.
And what do you do on board?
I work in the iCafe, which is the cafe downstairs. So if you'd like some ice cream or popcorn after you browse the book fair, I will be there to serve you.
Wonderful, wonderful. Give them all a big hand. The Logos Hope Parade of Nations. Thank you.
Samuel Hills, who hails from Germany, is the captain of the Logos Hope. This is the fourth time that he is serving on the boat. Captain Hill said that it is a team effort to keep the vessel afloat.
It's my true honor and pleasure to welcome you on board the Logos Hope. The Logos Hope is not only the book ship, it's not only the ship coming to your country, exploring your country. It's not only the ship where teams going off into your community, it's also our home, our ship. And it's our delight to welcome you on board our ship, our home. And as you've seen it in the Parade of Nations, we're a multicultural community, and bringing the ship into your port is not only a one-man show. I couldn't do that without all my team around me. And as the Parade of Nations represents all these nationalities, so does my professional crew as well. There's my officers. He actually was part of the Parade of Nations from Norway. You remember Andre Bura. He's my second officer. Then I have a chief engineer who is from the Netherlands. I have my medical officers from Germany and engine officers from Korea, and on and on and on I could go. We're all working together and we're keeping the ship afloat. And yeah, we're going from shore to shore. And every time we're coming into a new country, we're getting excited about what to explore new. Getting to know the people is our main focus, and we're really looking forward to this next 2 weeks in your country, St. Vincent and the Grenadines. I know that we will have teams going off to the Grenadines in the next days as well, meeting your people over there, because they might not be able to come over here to visit the book ship, the book fair on board here. And again, it's my pleasure to welcome you. And I'm thankful for you all who made it possible to receive us in your port of Kingstown. Thank you very much.
The managing director of the Logos Hope is South Korean Pil Hon Park. He joined the Logos in 1994. Park explains the mission of the Logos Hope.
The mission of Logos Hope is to advance the well-being of people everywhere. This is achieved in several ways. Sharing knowledge, by making available many good books, and sharing help by assisting educational, social, and healthcare projects. Sharing hope by affirming right values and worth of every human being before God. Often our visitors ask, how can you survive in an international community like this? They seem to think it would be impossible. Although we face difficulties from time to time, we live and work together on the ship by seeking to understand others' point of view. We say to our people, if you don't understand, don't misunderstand, and do all you can to build some understanding. We learn this from the Bible. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interest, but to the interest of others. This is the teaching by which we endeavor to live. Secondly, we live and work together by esteeming others, regardless of their color, culture, or creed. On board the Logos Hope, we desire to express the heart of esteem, the heart of appreciation of all cultures, both those on board and those cultures that we visit. Finally, we want to reflect the love of our God through our ordinary lives and our efforts to better the life of others.
And Minister of Foreign Affairs and Deputy Prime Minister, the Honorable Sir Louis Straker, welcomed the Logos Hope to St. Vincent and the Grenadines, noting that the impact of having the book ship here will be tremendous. Sir Louis urged Vincentians to visit the ship and to capitalize on the discounted literature available on board.
And while they're here, I'm told that they might get involved in seminars and conferences for men and women, and boys, girls, youth, and children. So we appreciate what they have brought to our shows here. It's the world's largest floating book fair. And the name is fascinating. Logos Hope. Logos, Pastor Frederick would tell me, is the Greek word meaning word, speech, or reason. And they have brought the written word here to us so that they might try to dispel ignorance, and they might try to alleviate us out of poverty. We must be able to show some appreciation for the books that are being brought here, and I'm told there are 5,000 titles, except for those who have traveled to the more developed countries of the world. We have never seen anything like this in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, where we can find 5,000 books in one place. And in these books, I am sure, would be treasured the longings of heart, the thoughts of great men, those who have put pen to paper in order to enable us to learn from their experience and to be benefited from the knowledge that they have.
A cultural presentation was most welcomed from some of the Indian crew members.
Sore ni khabar so.
And after all of the formal speeches, Sir Louis Straker cut the ribbon, signaling the official opening of the Logos Hope at the Kingstown Container Port.
We invite you, Sir Louis, to officially open Logos Hope to the public at St. Vincent and the Grenadines.
I'm delighted to do this. Officially open.
Now, please do join us, look around the book fair, follow us in.
Those in attendance were then given the opportunity to check out the book fair. The Logos Hope is opened to the public from Tuesday to Saturday, 10 a.m. to 9 p.m., Sundays from 2 p.m. to 9 p.m. It can be accessed by the entrance at the Geest Shed. I am Shanna Daniel, reporting for the API.
Coming up next on Inside Story, Dr. Camille Niklos talks about diabetes care. Stay with us.
See, mommy real busy right now. Just take a snack from the counter.
No, mommy. Those haven't too much salt in it. Can I have a fruit, please?
That's an interesting choice. But where did you learn that?
The people on Health Road. No, mommy. You want to kill me with high blood pressure? Health Road says whatever salt you eat for the whole day should not be more than one teaspoon. And that is just for adults, you know.
Foods may contain more salt than you think. Reduce salt intake.
For most women, pregnancy is an exciting time. It's what makes us feel that we're a woman because we are producing children. A lot of women, when they can't produce children or they can't make children, can go through depression. And we may have to send them to Dr. Miller to try and help them through this sad time of their lives. Pregnancy causes lots of changes, physiological, physical, and hormonal changes. As you know, pregnancy is 40 weeks and we have 3 trimesters. For most women, when they find out they're pregnant, they can't wait for the heartbeat and they come to the doctors and you can hear the baby's heartbeat. They get all excited when they get the kicks. But some women do have diabetes and this causes a challenge for us, and we need to be able to help these ladies when they become pregnant. When we're talking about diabetes and pregnancy, you need to know that there are 2 types of patients who fall into this category. Let's call them clients, because the pregnant woman is not a patient. She is a woman who has got a physiological change, and we're here to help her. So we have the woman who has diabetes and finds herself pregnant, and we call that diabetes in pregnancy. We also have the pregnant woman who finds out at some point, normally in the second, third trimester, that she has diabetes, and we call this gestational diabetes. The third category is a category that we make normally after delivery. This is the patient or the woman who does not know that she has diabetes. She turns up at the clinic sometimes late, and the healthcare providers, you know, one of the challenges we have is getting our mothers to come to clinic early. So she turns up to the clinic in a second or third trimester We do the screening and then we find out that she's got diabetes. Is she somebody who has gestational diabetes, or is she somebody who had diabetes but we did not know? And at the end of it, we will have to find out and help her with that. The mainstay, of course, is checking her blood sugars on a regular basis. Beverly talked about Diabetes Month. We're only celebrating a week, but normally, internationally, I think it's a month that we use. Let's go back to the woman who is diabetic. Ideally, that patient or that woman who is diabetic should get pre-pregnancy counseling before she gets pregnant, okay? Ideally, we want to make sure that she's got good glucose control within 3 to 6 months before she gets pregnant. And everybody knows what the hemoglobin A1C is. That's our way of assessing the patient to determine if she's got good glucose control or not. During our talk with her, or during consultation, we want to know what medication she's on, because we know a lot of the medications that's being used for the diabetic patient can be tetratogenic. And if she's trying to get pregnant, we may want to change or switch her medication onto something that is safe. We want to talk to her about diet and exercise, and of course, any woman who is considering getting pregnant, we want her to start folic acid, because we know that folic acid helps with prevention of neural tube defects. These are our target goals. Before eating or fasting, we want her sugar levels to be between 60 and 119. And 1 hour after meals, it should be about 100 to 149. Why is it we want the patients or the women to have good control before she gets pregnant? We know that sugar diabetes increases the risk of birth defects. Babies' organs are formed by week 10. Most of us women do not remember or know when our periods are. So by the time you realize that you're pregnant, damage is done to the organs of the baby. Now this shows you, this is a baby that's about 12 weeks, and you could see that the baby is fully formed. You've got 10 fingers, 10 toes. So basically what I'm trying to get across to you, we need to make sure we have good glucose control before you get pregnant, because we want to make sure at the end of it that the baby is healthy. What are the risk factors? If you don't have good glucose control, you have an increased risk of miscarriage. We talk about birth defects, including heart defects, neural tube defects, which is the spinal cord. Kidneys can be deformed, and the sacrum can be deformed. Poor glucose control leads to macrosomia. These are the large babies. When the baby is born and we clamp that cord, that baby can have become hypoglycemic, increased risk of jaundice, and the babies come out having difficulty breathing. This is because that the surfactant, which is a complex lipoprotein that helps to make the lungs open up, is delayed in terms of maturity, and these babies have difficulty breathing. Maternal risk, if you're diabetic and you're not controlled, the pregnancy is going to exacerbate the symptoms, and you get exacerbation of your kidneys, your eyes, increased risk of bladder infection. Preeclampsia, Dr. Thompson touched on hypertension in the diabetic patient. We have a unique condition that we see in pregnancy called preeclampsia. This is where your blood pressure goes up, you have kidney damage, and you lose a lot of protein in the urine. Patients can die from preeclampsia if it's not controlled. The diabetic mother, if she ends up with a very large baby, can have a difficult birth delivery. There's a frightening condition that we see very rarely, where we have what's called shoulder dystocia, where the baby head comes out and we have difficulty delivering the baby, and the baby can die. And because the babies get very big, we can end up with doing lots of cesarean sections. So we want to encourage the mother, whether we need to make sure that she's on her insulin and taking it regularly, switching her diabetic pills. Remember, we are not eating for two. This is a myth in the Caribbean that, oh, I'm pregnant, I'm eating for two. We are not eating for two. We just need to eat healthily. Weight gain, and of course, we should be able to exercise. Okay, so these just show, just to reinforce, Now, I put up this slide, metformin. When I was going to medical school, we were told that if you're diabetic and you're pregnant, we could only control it using insulin. Recent studies have shown, well, not recent, in the last 15 years, that we can actually use metformin to help control the pregnant diabetic mother. So if we have a mother who is already on metformin, we can actually keep them on the metformin, and that can help to control the diabetes during the pregnancy. Don't forget exercise. We don't advocate you starting to exercise during pregnancy, but obviously you continue your regime, and your body will tell you how far you can go. We don't expect you to go up climbing La Soufriere, but you know, gentle walking, low impact with weights would help with your diabetes. Now, I know a lot of you are going to ask me about this. If you're obese, we only want you to put on about 15 pounds. Now, you and I know that that is very difficult. We want you to have a caloric diet of about 1,500 calories. Now, if you eat 3 Snickers bars in a day, that's 1,500 calories. So that gives you an idea how low your diet has to be. So we want you to eat more vegetables and fruits, and cut down on your carbohydrates. We don't want you to starve. If you're accustomed eating 2 slices of cake, maybe half a slice of cake. If you're accustomed to ice cream, maybe consider yogurt. Juices, that would be, so you want to drink maybe coconut water. Apple juice is very low in calories. Just drinking water would help. And cut out the Bust and the Fanta and the Coke, where you have lots and lots of calories. Sorry? Gestational diabetes. This is diabetes that's developed in a pregnant woman. Approximately 10% of women will get gestational diabetes, and it occurs within the late second and third trimester. Why you get gestational diabetes, we're not sure. We know you can have a very strong family history, but the clues to help us is that the placenta supports the baby and produces hormones which helps the baby to develop. However, those same hormones block the action of the maternal insulin, and we end up with insulin resistance. Now, Dr. Thompson talked a lot about insulin resistance, but we're looking at it from the context of the pregnant mother. So this is a schematic showing you the role of the placenta. The placenta is the most important organ in a pregnancy. Why? Because you need to get maternal circulation to that baby. Oxygen and nutrients need to go from the uterus to the baby, and it's done via the placenta. Okay, so this is the placenta, this is the umbilical cord. And then the umbilical cord would take waste and carbon dioxide from the baby back into the maternal circulation. So the placenta has a role. However, the hormones that's produced by the placenta can increase insulin resistance. Insulin resistance means that the mother has to work about 3 times as much to help her. Basically, your body is not able to make all the insulin that's required. Because of this, the glucose cannot leave the maternal circulation, and you end up getting hyperglycemia in pregnancy. This is just a schematic showing you how it works. The pancreas is not producing enough insulin, or it's not effective. It gets raised glucose levels, and then it affects the baby. The good thing about gestational diabetes, if you can call it a good thing, is that by the time it presents, it does not affect the baby in terms of birth defects. So the baby of a gestational diabetic mother will not have any birth defects, because remember I said earlier that the organs are formed by week 10 of life. So we do not have any problems with birth defects. The pancreas, however, is working overtime. It's producing insulin, but the insulin produced by the mother does not cross the placenta. Glucose does cross the placenta, so the baby's pancreas now is trying to make as much insulin, and the extra energy, the baby produces fat. So you get a macrosomic baby, fat baby. This leads, as I mentioned, to a difficult delivery. When the baby is born and we clamp that cord, the baby can get hypoglycemia, and we need to have the pediatricians at delivery so that they can titrate and give the baby some glucose until it's sorted out. We mentioned already the breathing problems, and these babies are at risk of obesity. And again, Dr. Thompson talked about the 5 and 6 and 7 year olds with obesity, and these babies are at risk of developing diabetes later on. What are the maternal risks for gestational diabetes? Over 25 years. Now, you know we like to tell our girls don't get pregnant, they shouldn't get pregnant at 17, 18, 19, 20. But if they do get pregnant, they may not get gestational diabetes, so we have to balance. If they have a family history, previous history of gestational diabetes, once you've had gestational diabetes in a previous pregnancy, chances are it's going to come back in subsequent pregnancies. Previous stillbirth, if you had a baby that had a birth defect, excessive weight, and the non-white race. The American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists actually said that all black women should be screened for gestational diabetes. But we cannot afford to screen everybody in St. Vincent. We are a black race, so basically we're talking about screening every woman who is pregnant. We don't have the socioeconomic funds to do that. So we would use a different parameter. If you have a previous stillbirth, a previous big baby, family history, if you have persistent glucose in the urine, these are some of the things we would use to help us to screen. For the healthcare providers that are here, and I don't know if we have any, but one of the things you should be looking out for, if you are assessing a woman in the antenatal period in clinic and you notice that her fundus, the belly, the uterus is getting larger than you would expect, start thinking that this patient might be developing gestational diabetes, because basically what you're having is excess fluid because of the pregnancy. Some of the complications that we see is preeclampsia, we talked about that. Trauma, you have a big baby coming through the vagina, you could end up with tears, lacerations, and bleeding. Complications from cesarean section, including poor wound healing because of all the excess fat. And this patient, the gestational diabetic patient, she has a 50% chance of getting adult onset diabetes by the time she gets to the age of 40. How do we prevent it? We can't really. But we know that if we eat healthily, keep active, and lose weight before pregnancy, these are some of the parameters that would actually help.
Stay with us. Inside Story continues in a moment. Don't go away.
St. Vincent and the Grenadines, the Caribbean you're looking for.
A lot goes into shaping an individual, but it all starts here. What may seem to us like simple fun is critical to their education and overall development. It's how they start to define and understand speech, how they develop their motor skills and hand-eye coordination. Remember, children are never too young to learn. This message was brought to you by the UNICEF Office for Barbados and the Eastern Caribbean, the Caribbean Child Support Initiative, and this station.
Welcome back. The principal and the staff of the intermediate high school, as its mission statement says, is doing its part to equip their students with a well-rounded education. The school has a band, and the students recently performed at the Ministry of Education and the Republic of China Taiwan Scholarship Handout Ceremony. They were well received by the audience. Thus, the API was motivated to meet with the band members and their music teacher. The students are all hats and this transcends to their music. The API visited the school on Friday, November 17, 2017. Thank you.
we are at the band room of the intermediate high school. We have the band with us. We are grateful for you, Mr. Olivier, and your students taking the time out to come and talk to us.
For us. When I first started music, I heard it from Independence Day. And I say, if I could learn that, it can benefit my life.
To be honest, I knew I was getting a whole set of trouble until I meet music. Then I started to settle down and play.
First time I played on the stage, it was a challenge because I got nervous sometimes. Then my teacher insists of me playing the clarinet. I was curious about it.
On my extreme right, we have Akeem Ince. We have Mr. Tristan Glynn, Javed Richardson, Dwayne Sam, and Brittany.
We are curious to know how the band started, whose idea was it, and what year did it start?
Okay, so I teach music here at the Intermediate High School, and of course an important part of any music program is trying to have actual performance being done. This group of students that you see here is a very new batch of students in terms of working together as a band within the school. Pretty much most of them came together this term to actually start working together. Mr. Ince, for instance, he's learning the clarinet in the Cadet Force Band. Javed is learning trumpet in the Cadet Force Band. So they are here at the school, so we incorporate that as far as possible. Mr. Sam and I believe Brittany as well also learned pan starting out at the C.W. Prescott Primary School. So, I mean, whatever students we have presently who are already involved in music, I try to break, bring them in rather than always having to start from scratch as well. Instruments are limited, and I think that is a problem right across St. Vincent at schools. Instruments are not cheap. Right, instruments are not cheap, and especially when you're in the Caribbean, you know, getting instruments from abroad and so on, the cost goes up very quickly. But you are fortunate from time to time that you have well-wishers who may donate instruments and so on to the school. So the program is something that we'd like to develop more and more, but it will be vital to get support in terms of, you know, getting instruments and that sort of thing. Any ensemble that you have, and this is a very small ensemble, any ensemble that you have a key instrument, especially, you know, playing pop music, playing reggae, or any of the local or Caribbean styles of music, a drum kit, for instance, is a very vital piece of instrument. We don't have one, right? We have tried reaching out to various agencies from time to time. We have a little success here or there, but altogether it's a challenge to try to get instruments to, you know, embellish the program a bit more. But one step at a time, one day at a time. Once you start with a few, hopefully things grow and you move on from there.
Hopefully from being on our program, some kind-hearted person or persons will hear your plea and respond accordingly. Good. So, as you mentioned, they all have some background in music. If any member of any student of this school is interested in learning to play an instrument, are you open to this sort of thing?
Yes, as far as possible, you try to accommodate that. Wherever time allows itself, you try to make that happen. Of course, teaching full-time at the school also means that teaching an instrument separately is something you do, you know, during your lunch hour, your break time, or after school, and so on. The work that these students have done over the past few weeks is primarily, you know, them sacrificing time while they're at school. You know, there are many days we spend our entire break period, so they rush from one class, they grab something to eat quickly, they get to the space, we start practicing, the bell goes, you drop everything, you rush back to class. At the end of the school day, you come back, you rehearse some more to make sure everything is tight enough for performance. So it is then, in trying to teach a student another instrument, is also now fitting in that time outside of the regular schooling day to make that happen. But where possible, we try to do that once you show the interest. And once an instrument is also available at the school to do so. Yeah.
Well, it shows some dedication on your part and also on the student's part. And I'm sure being a part of this band and learning music on a whole has some benefits. When you teach music in your ordinary classes, what do you tell your students in terms of it's not just a subject or just to pass an exam? I mean, what is the benefit of learning music?
All right, now That has been a long-standing discussion in a variety of places. Music onto itself is a language onto itself that you learn, and you learn how to express it. Additionally, you're playing from a sheet of music, and there's a lot of mathematics also going on. You know, you see a note, it lasts for a particular period of time. You have to use some sort of recognition of ratios. How do I fit that into the speed at which the music is going? All these factors. Some of the things you would also hear raised is that, you know, the cognitive abilities of the students improve. The awareness of what is happening around them improves. The ability to follow instructions. A composer writes a piece of music and expects it to be performed a particular way. You have to understand the styling of that and how that, you know, fits into what you have to do. How do you express that in its truest sense? It creates also a sense of discipline, because to be a musician is not a fly-by-night thing. It's not just, oh, I think I would like to play the keyboard today, so I look at it over there in the corner, I sit there, I spend, you know, 2 minutes, I press some keys, and oh, wonderful, I'm a keyboardist, right? No, it takes dedication, it takes spending time daily practicing, it takes the support of your peers, of your parents, of family members who would say, you know, yes, you're struggling today, but you're improving, right? And assure you that, hey, stick with it, you will develop at it. So while a lot of persons also made the argument that because you're doing music, things like your mathematics skills would improve, your concentration levels, being able to focus more on your subjects and so on will improve. And, you know, there have been a number of studies that said through playing music, the overall well-being of the student is improved, and the ability to focus and dedicate themselves on their schooling in itself improves.
Have they shown any improvement in their academics? Have you seen the results yourself among your students?
Well, I would say generally for my time here at school, in a variety of ways, the students that tend to be involved with the program, they start doing better.
Also socially.
Yes, so your academics start improving, but it's not just the academic. It is you as an individual. You start, you know, your self-esteem improves. I mean, it's a pretty cool thing to get up in front of your peers at school and play a song like the one we recorded today. I mean, you get up in front of the school and perform that, and everybody goes crazy, and you're thinking, yeah, that's me up there doing that. You know, it lifts you, the individual, which also encourages you to be better. And of course, if you're working with me as a student, you have to. You don't really have much choice in it. You have to step up.
You stress that.
Yeah, you have to step up. There are things that I expect you to be better at. You have to be more disciplined. You have to pay attention to, I mean, the way you dress. You have to pay attention to your timeliness. All these factors that at the end of the day, if you decide to take this to another level, are things that are going to be vital. In the music industry, all those things are things that are going to be important for you. Your attitude sometimes would even take you further than where your skills on an instrument might, because you...
Attitude and presentation.
Exactly. There are times when somebody, you know, might be looking for a musician, but they know that your professionalism is very poor. Your skills may be fantastic, but I really don't want to work with you because you have very poor skills. But you may have another person who is not as good, but when it comes to professionalism, you're always on time, you are prepared, you do your homework. All these factors are critical things of being a professional. So I try to instill that in the students that I work with, that we are striving for excellence. Because when you think of it, in a lot of subject areas and so on, you might say, hey, a kid performed, they scored 80%, that's great, they scored an A. You scored 75%, you got a B, and that's fantastic. And I'm not disputing that. But a musical group goes out and performs at 75%, it doesn't really sound too fantastic, right? So while, yes, you know, good grades are good, when you're performing as a band, you're always striving to be as close to perfection as possible, because a few mistakes here and there does detract from it. So it's always striving for that 100%. So the attitude always has to be, this has to be on point. Thank you.
When I first started music, I heard it from Independence Day. And I say, if I could learn that, it can benefit my life. So I try up drums, I practiced drum for so much years, and then I tried trumpet. And hearing the song made me feel proud, because it's in the Bible that trumpet was played. And I want to feel how trumpet played and how it has benefited my life. Learning beats and stuff like that. Going in classroom, listening, being focused. You play music, you have to focus. So being in class, you have to focus the same way. So that's how it impacts on music. My parents, they are proud. They say keep it up and hope that my music can reach far in my life.
What form are you in?
Form 3.
Sorry. What's your name?
Dwayne Sam.
Where are you from, Dwayne?
Lowman's Hill.
Lowman's Hill is Lowman's Camden Park?
Yes, please.
Okay, what form are you in?
I'm in Form 3.
Also in Form 3?
Yes, please.
So tell us how you got started in music and why do you like to play music?
I learned music at the Cedar Prescott Primary School with my band teacher, Kessel and Taffer Wilson. To be honest, I knew I was getting a whole set of trouble until I meet music. Then I started to settle down and play here, and it has changed my life.
I like that when you met music, like music, it's a person, you know, like it's a force.
Yeah, miss, I love music real bad.
So how did you get started in music, and what do you think are the benefits of music in your life?
Well, I got into music when I started playing the recorder. I got more into it, I practiced. The first time I played on the stage, it was a challenge because I got nervous sometimes. Then my teacher insists of me playing the clarinet. I was curious about it. It was a bit of a challenge. I don't know how I was supposed to do it, but when I more got into it, I developed on it.
So you say your teacher from cadet?
Yeah.
So can you read music?
Yeah, I got more into music. I started reading the notes more, and it did good for me.
What do you think this is leading you?
It will lead me into music, and yeah, it will probably do good for me. It will do good for me, actually, yeah.
I like that.
Okay. I love to play instruments. I don't really think that I will be in a band, but the purpose that I want to learn all instruments. Not to be as perfect as I can, but learn them, but I haven't seen myself in like doing being a band. Just might join the army. I didn't army or something. Yeah.
You want to join the army?
Yeah, some of that.
You could play music in the army.
Yeah.
coming around to Dwayne?
Yes, I would like to be a pan teacher.
You follow in your footsteps of your former pan teacher at CW Prescott?
Yes, I love my pan teacher.
I'm sure he's very proud of you.
He is.
Yeah, so thank you for talking to us, and we wish you all the best in your future endeavors. We'll be looking to be, you know, we're looking to hear stuff from you, good stuff, because you sung really good from my novice ears. So, and we wish that you get the equipment and the room. I think this is your room. You just don't want to call it your room. This is your room. Yes, yeah, so thank you for talking to us, and all the best.
Thank you very much for coming. Thank you very much for coming. It's an honor. When we got your call, we were very surprised, and it was very pleasing to have you be interested in coming to speak with us. It shows that we are doing something right. And you know, we just continue to try to do more good things, more right things, and hopefully down the road there's a lot more you could come back and see and report on, and again that we can have the support of our communities to help us to grow from strength to strength. So thank you once again for, you know, featuring us and giving us this opportunity.
Thank you.
That is all the time we have on this edition of Inside Story. Thanks for watching. I am Ashisi Asam. See you next time.